There is no championship leader here this evening. Big, big news then, coming into the fifth round of this, your Synology GT3 Championship. Iru Nom will not be able to participate. He has a one race ban, some misdemeanors he said earlier on in the week. You can't afford to miss this race. We're on iRacing Live and Racebot TV next. We are underneath the floodlights then as qualifying looks to get itself to a close. Just one driver then out on track at the moment. That is Raul Huben right now. His time's down. You're the 25th currently in the 044 machine with Iru Nom away due to a ban. It's time for the others to play on Racebot TV and on iRacing Live. This is your Synology GT3 Championship brought to you by TMS Motorsport. TMS Motorsport offers a comprehensive range of tuning parts for all makes and models with competitive pricing, worldwide delivery, and great customer service. Visit them today at tmsmotorsport.co.uk. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Jake Sperry back in the booth then, joined alongside with Connery Maddock. Connery, Roe Hooven's going to be coming to the line right now, but Iru Nom away due to some misdemeanors that he's been saying there behind closed doors. Well, one of four drop weeds used, and not the way you want to use them.
No, definitely not. As Roel Huben sets his time of a 201.2, that'll only be good enough for 21st. But yes, Iru Nom not going to participate in this race, and that could mean many things for the championship right now. He's not the only one that's gotten the race ban, though. Jan Miltzver also picking up that one race ban for things said outside of the race.
Yeah, certainly has done. Of course, there's a three race ban for Taylor Lane as well. That's for giving an incorrect age for signing up to the lead. Of course, in standards, in line with the MSA rules that are there and applied as present. Qualifying is all but over. This is how the grid is going to get itself sorted up. Gareth Mesham then on the pole position there, 159.141, a fantastic lap. He's joined by Scott Brazier, a race winner this season. Jason Dilworth will line up on the second row there with the driver of Phil Rose. Barry Baird there in fifth will be looking to capitalise on the championship gap left open with Ben Hackerson there in sixth, the reigning champion. Paul Wormsley will be there in seventh position with Daniel Page eighth. Ben Warren then will start up in ninth position with Bart Dahlman there in tenth. And looking further back, the likes of Soren Kroos and Adam Afton. Bram Reiners and Mike Mason, Simon Underhill and JPW Ringwood. Surprisingly, Danny Order in 15th and 16th respectively. With the likes of John Cook, Paul Martin, Matisse van Delden's there. Ryan Atmore there, Danny Order 20th. You've got Roel Huben there in 21st. We just saw him in qualifying. Neil Bamber there in 22nd. Alan McCain alongside him with Philip Gregory. Andrew Tobert there in 25th with Randy Walker. You've got Anthony Marsh, Chris Butterill there with Jason Withrow, Moore Herman, Simon Jackson, Martin Brandon, John Roberts, Jonathan Beresford, Dave White, Daniel Bailey, and Rick Fowler rounds out 37 cars on the grid right now. Got to remember though, Connery, some rule changes have come into effect here with these 2 minutes coming on, because for the rest of the season, we are going to go for a rolling start instead of a very, very precarious standing start.
Yeah, it's perhaps the standard for GT3 racing that this rolling start has been implemented. The standing starts were fun, but I felt like the series organizers felt that a few too many wrecks were caused by it. So we're just going to go with a standard rolling start for this race. They were going to do it anyway for the 2 hour endurance in quote marks races, but now they're going to do it for every single race of the season. And it's just going to thin the field out just a little bit when the green flag flies and try and prevent some of those incidents.
Yes, and what it is going to do, it means that all eyes will turn to Gareth Mesham then at the front of the field when he does get back around a circuit like this. Of course, remember, you are under the floodlights on a circuit like this, but when you have to deal with Sebring here, Connery, it's a very difficult circuit because of certain measures. The pace car will be looking to get away right now as it will go one time by, then come down onto lane. Something crucial to note is the track is lit only on the front straight and at very various points, very specific points around the circuit. For most of the lap, you are spent entirely in darkness, and with that visibility gone, that is going to cause some drivers a few issues.
It definitely is, and that has been telling in the qualifying as well. Gareth Mesham was his first ever pole position. Scott Brazier perhaps where we perhaps expect him to be inside that top three, top five. But other drivers, Jason Dilworth, Phil Rose, Barry Baird, Benjamin Hackson, Paul Wormsley, Daniel Page, some of those names we haven't really seen this far up the field, especially in qualifying. So maybe this being a night race has definitely been a factor that has meant that some of your drivers deal with it better and some of them worse.
Some of them worse, maybe. Now they head through the right here of turn number 6 on circuit. This is known as Big Bend. You take it flat out and hope to goodness gracious that you get yourself a great run coming into the next chicane that will be coming up in the right, left, right that's coming up. Then you've got that Fangio chicane as you head then up to the corner of Cunningham. Connery, one of the things about this circuit, I call it very similar to Silverstone, not because of its layout, but because of the nature that the track was created. It's an old airfield here in the United States of America, and the way it's been constructed, the way it's been created, it's a very bumpy circuit. You've got areas of the track where you're having to deal with the suspension a little bit differently to, say, your normal racing circuit. And something else that's very interesting and also probably unique to a circuit like this, you go from asphalt to concrete, and that change in surface is very, very telling.
Yeah, it definitely is. And you just talked about the bumps on this circuit. One of the trickiest corners on this circuit is the final corner of Sunset Bend. There's some absolutely vicious bumps during that corner. If you hit those, you could be going straight into the wall. But as they're just coming towards the sort of middle of the lap right here, so it's quite a long pace lap right here. I believe they're just coming into Cunningham Corner. And they'll just make their way through. There's a little bit of dirt on the outside of the corner, which can get kicked up and onto the track a little bit. We saw that the 12 hours of Sebring last year, where there was a lot of dirt strewn across the track. But since this is not a 24-hour race, I don't think we'll be seeing much of that.
Maybe we won't, but we do have 1 hour. One pit stop, of course, is required in a race like this. You've got to make sure that you get down to the lane, and that strategy call will be oh so important. That was Tower Corner they came through. Now they head into this big right, turns into the left here of Le Mans. Now, Le Mans is a very interesting corner here because you can see those cars on the outside right now going over that white line to maximize the circuit to come back in on this long and get themselves the best run down this Ormond straight, this back straight there, you can say, and it will be one corner to go. And it's about now Gareth Mesham should be thinking about backing up the field a little bit, allowing that pace car to just get itself down onto the lane and giving himself free rein to do whatever he wants. He doesn't want to be stuck waiting for the green flag, waiting for the pace car to get itself in. Sunset Bend is the final corner then that these cars will negotiate. A million different lines then down into this corner. Which one's the right one? Well, nobody really knows then as they head down into the corner. You can see a gazillion cones on the outsides of corners marking braking points. We might see a couple of cones fly then during this one, but keep your eyes then on the front. The 030 will have the pace, and it's Gareth Mesham who has it, and he will go straight away then as the green flag flies, and he gets the jump then on Scott Brazier coming in. Dilworth will take third then as they head into a very tricky 3-2 turn at number one. Then a little look to the inside then from the driver Scott Brazier, but nowhere near too wide. They're going to go behind then Barry Baird looking to go down the inside. Paul Wormsley, there's contact there with Ben Hackerson, and Hackerson and Wormsley then turn around. Hackerson waiting on the inside, and very, very lucky that there isn't any more damage, Connery.
Yeah, definitely. That was just coming into the latter part of turn one right there. The exit of that corner really does narrow. It's like a bottleneck, and your drivers have to get relatively organized very, very quickly.
There's a car in the wall, actually. That's Phil Rose, and it's also Barry Baird as well, who was up there fighting second to third in the championship. He'll be waiting to go around. Phil Rose has not. So this has happened then, coming into Big Ben, and 2-1. It doesn't go, Connery, especially around here. Barry Baird cannot afford it, especially when the main championship leader's not here.
Yeah, that was actually Phil Rose trying to go too wide with Jason Dilworth through there ahead of Barry Baird, and I believe that was the car Phil Rose just getting all sorts of loose over the curb, and he ends up in the wall as we look towards the lead.
Yeah, in the moment Scott Brazier then having Gareth Mesham then for a lot of problems right now as they head into Tower Corner. Then Mesham will hold it for the moment. It's a two-car breakaway after the incident between Baird and Rose right now. Mesham there in first, Brazier second, Dilworth then in third, with Page in fourth and Warren in fifth. And you can see that big train then from third backwards looking to try and manifest itself right now into Le Mans. Then come your leading two. Gareth Mesham has had the perfect start, then Brazier as well, because he knows from behind now it's going to be even more difficult for them to catch up. And now the slipstream effect will come into play around a circuit like this here, Connery, because you've got that chance for Scott Brazier now to close in. Maybe he might have a look then, waiting for the cones. There's the cones, and no, he's not going to get the chance. He tried a look, but it wasn't going to happen.
Yep, as they come through the final corner on lap one of the race here at Sebring, coming out of Sunset Bend, coming down the pit straight. Scott Brazier still sitting in that slipstream. Will he have a look coming down into turn one? There goes Mesham, defensive line on the inside for turn one. Has to force Scott Brazier in that Ford GT around the outside. Scott Brazier, get it slowed down before they exit the corner. He tries, he clips the gravel, and they still take a 2-wide coming down into turn two.
Yeah, down to turn three even then on the brakes, and it gets bumpy and single file. You can see he just gets caught on the outside, had to keep it on the road, and that's just brought the driver of Jason Dilworth back into play. 1.6 seconds gone in a blink of an eye. That's how difficult it is to make a move. And you know what? Brazier's not done, because he'll look to the outside then, looking for a way through then out of Big Ben, looking as they head to the hairpin then, one of the slowest parts of the circuit. Not going to happen down here. Has to wait for a different opportunity somewhere else. Laps around here, you're looking at about 2 minutes here, just a fraction under for a lap. And you can see here, he's going to look for it. It goes all over the back bumper, and there's a little bit of contact between the two of them, but they keep it together into Cunningham. Round the outside will try Scott Brazier. Guys, this isn't the last lap of the race. This is only the second, and he still looks to the inside, turns to the outside. Can't do it for the moment, Connery.
Yeah, coming down into the braking zone off Tower Bend right now. And Jason Dilworth, look, he's just come out of nowhere. As you said, 1.6 seconds back. That has completely been reduced to only a couple of tenths right now. That A-corner printing BMW right on the back of your two leaders right now as they come through. I believe this is...
Oh, smash him around! Oh my word, and that's a solo effort there. Gareth Mesham's turned it around, and that's a big, big mistake. You can see he's hitting reverse, trying to make sure he gets out of the way of everyone. He gets it going again. Who is he just behind? The answer is Bram Reiner. So he's dropped a lot of positions. Replay on screen, and the pressure told. Brazier has forced the mistake out of Mesham, and now Scott Brazier takes the lead.
Yep, single car instant, even before the apex, just gets the back end out on entry, didn't even clip the grass either. And that wasn't Bishop Corner, actually, that was turn 15, the turn just before Le Mans. So now Gareth Mesham has a lot of work to do if he wants to get back anywhere near the front.
Yeah, and that is so, so crucial. Let's get a graphic up then. Biggest movers and shakers inside your top 10. Simon Underhill with a poor qualifying. He's got himself from 15th to 5th right now. He is plus 10. For the day right now, and he is doing a sterling job then here, looking to try and chase down Ben Warren, Daniel Page, Jason Dilworth, and Scott Brazier at the front of the field. Scott Brazier is the only driver inside your top five right now with a race win to his name at the moment. Not the only one with a podium. Simon Underhill will attest to that one at Bathurst, but you can see if they come down into the hairpin, there is all sorts of different cars. Ford GT leads the field right now, but behind that, BMW. Behind that, you're looking at that one again being a different car, again a different car, and you're looking at this one here. This balance of performance has come into its own economy here. It's one of those things where this circuit has so many different parts of it that legitimately you can say many drivers have many chances. Soren Kroos runs wide.
Yeah, you're definitely right there about the balance performance. The top three cars, it's Ford GT, BMW, and AMG Mercedes. There's a couple of AMG Mercedes in the rest of the top five, but then outside the top five, sixth place, there's a McLaren, and seventh and eighth for both Audis, then it's more Mercedes than Audis. So there's a good mix of drivers in different positions in different cars right here. So the balance of performance not mattering all that much around here.
Yeah, it certainly is. Matthijs van Delden then in the 008, looking at Paul Martin just ahead of him. Battle for 11th position then out on circuit. Not close enough yet into Le Mans, but we'll be looking to try and get that run. And Martin doesn't extend the track there. That's going to compromise the run coming out of the corner. Didn't feel confident enough to run and take that corner wide. So Matthijs van Delden then, with maybe a little bit of an advantage here in the 008 machine, moves to the right-hand side early. Goes and says, you know what, there's my big little look. And again, he just drifts over to the right-hand side looking for the opportunity. And you can see there's a gap open. He gets a massive tank slapper. And round goes van Delden into the wall.
Yeah, that's perhaps a little bit of a classic incident in Sunset Bend right there. Had an over-optimistic dive towards the inside, perhaps hit a couple of the bumps, just completely unsettled. The car got in a massive slide and heavy impact with the barrier right there. Well off the track, so the rest of your drivers had no problems getting through, as he's struggling with that car right now. He's going to bring it down pit road and get that fast repair.
Yes, he certainly is. Ben Haxon then around the outside of John from Beresford, then down in the lower part. He's looking to try and make his comeback, but you got drivers ahead who are looking to try and make some headway. Paul Wormsley, who had himself a bit of an issue on lap one, he's managed to get himself ahead of Ryan Walker and Simon Jackson. So Jackson there has himself a little bit of work to do. Haxon has got some work to do to get back then to Paul Wormsley. Of course, those two had the same incident, so those two will be looking like they will be trying to work together to get themselves back through the field as things stand. The gap, though, has opened up at the front now to about 8/10 of a second between Brazier and Dilworth there in second position. Dilworth, though, in that BMW, you have to say he will struggle a little bit more on the straights due to the fact that that car, that BMW, is such a great car in the corners. It has to sacrifice on the straights here, Connery, and that's what's going to be costing him the more that that draft goes away.
Yep, definitely. As we look at the 14 car and the 001, that is Benjamin Haxon just making his way through on Simon Jackson. So that's another position gain there from Benjamin Haxon, basically on a recovery drive right now after that earlier lap one incident. The next driver in his sights will be the driver of Ryan D. Walker. There's a little bit of damage to the rear end of that BMW right there, the Bo9 Solutions BMW. I think Benjamin Haxon will have this one easily done. Look how much he's caught up already.
Yeah, he certainly is making moves. Gareth Mesham also looking to try and make a move down the inside of Paul Martin. He'll look to get back into 11th position then on circuit. He'll look to the inside. He'll say thank you very much. And he'll say position is mine at Sunset Bend.
Oh, so he hits the wall. Please.
Yeah,
he hits the inside wall.
Yeah, and that is a really, really weird one there for Gareth Mesham there, just clipping that inside wall, and that has cost him two positions. So all that work he's got to do again, and now he'll have the added emphasis of maybe there's some damage on that vehicle. That will slow him down just a little bit more. Now he's got to spend this next half a lap feeling the car. Where can I push this car? When can I not? And again, runs wide at turn number one, showing that there's a little bit of doubt now in the vehicle.
Yeah, that is some damage to the right front wheel, I believe, on that car. So he's going to have to, well, he's going to probably be struggling just a little bit with that damage, but he's keeping on the back of the two drivers ahead of him. That's of Paul S. Martin and Abraham Arenas. Will Bram Mears have a little bit of a look on Paul S. Martin here? He has a look, he has a little bit of a weave. He's very deep on the brakes, and there's contact coming down into the hairpin corner on the corner. And oh, Paul S. Martin's going to be in the wall, and he's not going to be very happy about it.
No, he won't, and he keeps the car going. He's now behind John Cook there in the 52. And Captain Cook looking for it side by side, though, just ahead as Mesham goes around the outside. They touch, and round will go Gareth Mesham again. And he'll have to feel very, very frustrated. The red mist starting to descend now for Mesham, who's made mistake after mistake. And after unfortunate bygone circumstances, he is the innocent bystander in all of this. And now Mesham will lose the position to Anthony Marsh. And that is a big, big loss. And he's going backwards fast, Connery.
Yeah, I believe he thought the driver of Bram Reynolds was a little bit closer to the apex than he was. Reynolds did miss the apex by about a half a car width. And that is all that matters if a Gareth Mesham just trying to keep as tight a line as possible. And it just sends him around on the outside of the corner.
Yeah, it does. And that is going to be something that needs to be looked at then, maybe by the stewards, if Mesham is continuing to get involved in this one. It's also interesting to look at the front of the field now. Scott Brazier has opened up a 1.7 gap to Dilworth, who has opened up himself and almost a 2 second gap then to Daniel Page. And there's a three car battle then for the final spot on the podium right now, because you've got Daniel Page, Ben Warren, and your big mover and shaker in the form of Simon Underhill now on the back of Ben Warren, looking for a way through 007. Well, he's got a ticket to ride any day that he so pleases, and right now Simon Underhill looking for it, but I don't think he's close enough.
No, I don't think he's close enough just yet, especially when Baron Warren has a little bit of slipstream from his teammate ahead of him in the Bushfink Racing car right there. So two Bushfink Racing AMG Mercedes, and the leader of this field is a Bushfink Racing 4GT. It's just a shame they're not an official team in this series, otherwise they'll be leading the team championship.
Potentially they would, potentially they wouldn't, but look at Gareth Mesham once again then in the 030. He seems to keep coming back to him, because now he's on the back of Anthony Marsh looking to try and find a way through, but he's got to be careful because Paul Worms is coming. He looks to the inside, he takes a big, big dive at it, and he goes way too deep, has to take to the grass, and now he's being over-opportunistic here, Connery. Gareth Mesham is now paying the price for being in a situation where he is now frustrated with his racing right now. He's overdriving the car and doing too much with it.
Yes, and that's one of those things that can happen, especially if you've had an incident ridden first couple of laps of the race. You just start to try a little bit too hard, and those incidents just keep coming, and they just you just have to get your head in the right place and just calm down. Just try and take some deep breaths and just get on with the job. Just don't try too hard. That's my advice.
Yeah, that's the advice from Connery Maddock then. 101 on racing on the roads. JPW Ringwood then is there in 10th position, looking at Bart Daleman there just ahead of him. That gap was a second last time, about 1.1. That gap looking to come back down in, potentially moving on forward. The big train though is behind this driver in 15th position right now, the 018 of Ryan Atmore. And the train behind, you've got the likes of McCain, Paul Martin then under threat. Downy inside then goes Raoul Huben, and he'll say thank you very much, and then some, as he gets pretty much a second, second and a half. And Paul Martin struggling here. I think he wants to come down to pit.
Oh!
There's a miscommunication, and into the wall goes the other driver. So Paul Martin then trying to get onto the lane. Bit of miscommunication. It certainly does happen around Sunset Bend.
Yeah, that was Andrew Talbot just trying to make his way down the inside. He didn't know that Paul S. Martin was trying to head his way down pit road. As they confirm that over the driver radio, Andrew Talbot just asking, what was that? And then Boss Mine, I was trying to hit the pit road. And yeah, a little bit of miscommunication, and that's going to really be the end of Andrew Talbot's race right there.
Yeah, and that is the big, big one then for Talbot, who is looking for some consistent points. Paul Wormsley has just found a way past Anthony Marsh now. And actually, interesting just behind that, because you've got Ben Hackerson and Gareth Mesham, two drivers you thought would be fighting at the front. No, they won't be fighting at the front. They'll be looking to go on and fight here down for what it is 20th position as things stand. A little bit held up then on the exit of the corner there was the driver of Gareth Bethlehem, Anthony Marsh, then just trying to get that breakaway, but it wasn't going to quite happen in the way that he would have wanted. So a little bit of a waiting game then going again. Paul Walmsley, a little bit of damage there on Paul Walmsley's car there. I don't know if you've actually gone and checked this off there, Connery. That might be affecting his lap times here because he's only doing about 2:02s. His qualifying lap time a little bit different.
Yeah, that is actually some pretty significant damage to the front of that replacement Mercedes right there. And I'm surprised he's still keeping that car going and not bringing it down pit road to get that fast repair done. But he's not actually being caught, believe it or not, by Anthony Marsh. As we see Gareth Mesham, he tries to make his way down the inside, and it's going to be another incident right there. Anthony Marsh around and Mesham involved again.
Mesham is just being the banging and beating post then, and that is one that he cannot afford to be consistently, because he'll just keep racking them up, racking them up, racking them up, and he can't afford to just keep racking up. There is no incident limit in a series like this, but when you do get involved in incident after incident, you start to get a little bit of a reputation. Now Ben Hackerson going around the outside and trying around the outside, but what a drive off the corner there for Gareth Mesham. He says, thank you very much, see you later, mate. I've got myself about 0.4 of a second of a gap, and says no more about it. So Gareth Mesham holds on to that then, just for the time being right now. And Connery, you know, we are looking at this one, we are looking at these battles going on here and there, we are looking at all these emphasis going on. JPW Ringwood also starting to get into the mix then, starting to get into the battles right now. He's just got himself through on Bart Dahlman then for ninth position right now, crucial for what he needs to do.
Yeah, he is up a couple of places. He started 16th, he's up 7 to 9th place right now, and that is very important for his championship fight. He had a little bit of damage to the rear end of that Mercedes car right there, but not affecting him too much, as we have a battle down the field between Philip Gregory in his 9 car and Alan McCain. Philip Gregory just getting through right there, and Philip Gregory has actually been making the passes currently this lap. He's also gotten past Paul Walmsley somewhere as well. So he's been making his moves right there in that E-corner printing series.
Yeah, he certainly is, and he's doing a good job now getting back into the group. Getting forward here is the driver of Philip Gregory. He's now up 7 positions then for his day so far, doing a great job as things go on right now. But something to note here, there is only one driver in the field currently lapping under 2 minutes right now, and that's your race leader, 050 machine, Scott Brazier, then out and away, and continuing to go out and away as things stand right now. That gap is 3.4 seconds, and behind that it's a further 2.8 to the driver of Daniel Page. The three-car battle still going on, but again, they're pretty much staying in line, you could say here, Connery, in syncopation, waiting potentially for the pit stop window that's coming in about 10 minutes' time.
Yeah, definitely. You have to remember that Daniel Page and Ben Warren are currently teammates, so I don't think they'll be fighting too much for this final podium place. So this, at least this stage in the race, still a little bit too early for that, and we may have some more issues with Gareth Mesham. If I just look for him, he's dropping down the timing screens just a little bit, but actually he is still in track, and actually that was Benjamin Hackson going through right there.
It was Benjamin Hackerson making the pass, and a crucial pass then that gets him up into 19th position. Now his next challenge is to get past Alan McCain, and the difference is 5 seconds almost, well, 4.5, let's say, in that last lap compared to Alan McCain. Yes, McCain was overtaken, but, you know, a lot of time goes away when you start making small mistakes here. Small mistakes there. You've got to keep your eyes peeled on the road, and with that low visibility, that is going to be a problem. Battle I also want to point out to you here is the battle for sixth position right now. Soren Kroos in front, Adam Atherton behind. These two have been fighting right now and doing a very good job of things right now, Connery.
Yes, they are doing a very great job at things as they come through the final couple of corners of the lap. They're coming through Le Mans. Adam Atherton looking to get the good drive off the corner, but that the straight line speed of that McLaren of Soren Kroos is just gonna be completely dominant on this back straight. Nothing Adam Atherton can do. He's in the slipstream, but he's not even closing up too much. He does come close up in the latter stages of the braking zone right there, as actually Soren Kroos takes a wider line during a sunset bend, but Adam Atherton preferring to take the more tighter line to the wall, but in the end, not much between them.
Not much between them at all right now, and they can't quite do too much about it. 0.4 seconds into turn number one, 3 into 2 it goes. Of course, Joni Tamalo and Gregor Hutter came together last year in the iRacing Grand Prix World Championship Series there. Very iconic corner then in iRacing folklore. And actually going a little bit too deep in there was the driver of Adam Afton. That's going to cost him then a few tenths of a second that he can pretty much ill afford here in the situation that he has been dealt right now as racing continues then. This is the 10th lap of their race right now that they've got themselves onto. Three car pack there in the middle, Paul Wormsley then, the damaged Paul Wormsley, getting onto the back then now of Philip Gregory with Roel Huben there just ahead of them as well. And something to note here is that Paul Wormsley has been closing at a rate of knots. That last lap he did at 2:09 is about 0.8 seconds quicker than Philip Gregory, who's now looking at Roel Huben, who's starting to become a little bit of a bottleneck right now. It'll have to be around the outside he'll try here with the driver of Philip Gregory. It's not going to happen for the moment, I don't think, down to the brakes into here. He'll try it, but look at Wormsley down the inside. Ever opportunistic, can't go straight on behind.
Yeah, and he's risking losing another position right there as he gets into a tangle with Benjamin Hackerson coming off the corner. Philip Gregory will spin towards the inside on the grass right there. And oh, that was Benjamin Hackerson being very opportunistic right there. And I believe, I hope he doesn't mind me saying this, but Philip Gregory might have just squeezed him off the track right there, and Benjamin Hackerson wasn't having any of it.
No, he certainly wasn't. He wanted that little bit of track space and he wasn't going to get it. And because he didn't get it, it didn't work for him. Now Paul Wormsley all over the back of Roel Huben then in the 044, looking for a way through. Wasn't going to have it coming outside of tower through Bishop, the left-hander then. They come along now looking for that way through. Roel Huben then is going to have to try and play the game of defense as things stand right now. And he can't do it. Down the inside of Le Mans. Oh, brave attempt, but not going to happen then for the driver there of what is Paul Wormsley. Wormsley looking for a way through, but something to keep your eye on here, Hit Connery, is the fact that we got four cars when they last crossed the line who were all pretty incredibly close to each other, who were all there at the front of qualifying. You got Paul Wormsley, Ben Hackerson, Gareth Mesham, and Barry Baird as well, all fighting down for the lower half of your top 20.
Yeah, your qualifying grid has basically been flipped on its head if you just discount the top couple of cars right there. Fantastic movers in this race. Simon Underhill up 10 positions. Soren Cruz also up a good couple of positions right there as well, up 5 positions from 11th place to 6th. Adam Afton from 12th to 7th, and Mike Mason 14th to 8th. So big movers in your field.
Yeah, they certainly have been. And eyes on Simon Underhill right now because he is there in the 007 machine looking to have a little look at Ben Warren. It's not quite happening here just for the moment there. The 038 just ahead, not quite making the moves happen here, Connery. But that's one of those things. You've got to play a game of patience right now. And the patience factor for Simon Underhill is something he'll be looking to try and get going on forward. There is lap traffic ahead in the form of Martin Brandon that they'll try and need to negotiate later on in terms of this race. So Ben Warren doing a good job here on the defense right now. Heads down into this next section here. Le Mans coming up next. Now Ben Warren.
Oh, sorry, Jake. There goes the 12 around, or almost. That's a little bit of a half spin. That was Paul Wormsley. That was the battle between Paul Wormsley and Roel Huben that we were commenting on just a moment ago. And that was a go. That was just Roel Huben just a little bit too over-optimistic on the brakes right there. Coming down into that 90-degree right-hander just sends Paul Wormsley into a spin.
Replay then up on screen with that one, and Paul Wormsley then starting to get a little bit into the walls, and you can say getting into the walls. So is Barry Baird there, who is starting to get a little bit into the walls as well. Now stuck behind Ben Hackerson. Now it's Gareth Mesham's turn to get on Roel Huben, who runs a little bit wide then. And here comes Gareth Mesham then. Oh, he gets a big slide coming out of the corner, backs out of it completely, and almost had his day ruined there, Connery. Down in the inside retaining wall, you can see the paddock on the right hand side, left hand side, you probably see it on screen, and that could have been chaos for Gareth Mesham.
Yeah, and it could have been chaos multiple times during this race for Gareth Mesham, yet he's still out there relatively unscathed. He's lost a lot of time, but his car is looking fine. His right front damage isn't really affecting him all that much, but I think he's driving angry at this point, as one of our lovely YouTube viewers has said in the chat. He's driving angry right now, and he really needs to calm himself down, because one of these incidents could easily end his race.
Yeah, it certainly could. Simon Underhill's had a slowdown penalty as well. Now he's got Søren Kruse and Adam Atherton all over the back. That's 5 seconds that he's lost on that slowdown penalty alone. Simon Underhill then has had himself one of those issues. 52 has also come a little bit cropper. That's John Cook, who's had himself a little bit of an incident. And now he's under pressure then, as he has to try and fend off then the cars that are there looking to go with him. Ryan Atmore then holds position right now as they get around Rick Fowler. And behind that, that big train behind Raul Hooven, who's proving to be some very difficult defence. And he has pretty much the mainstays at the top of the field behind him. So for Raul Hooven, fair play, hats off. Great defending going on. The pit stop window's open, mind you, Conor. And one driver I have seen in right now so far is Matthijs van Delden.
Yes, indeed, as we still have a little bit of a look at Gareth Meshman. Is he going to make a move coming on Raul Hooven? He's going to make it relatively soon, but not just yet. There's some lap traffic ahead of him and Rick Fowler. Sorry, I'm getting mixed up between Raul and Rick. I'm pretty sure that has never happened before as they come through. They're coming into the braking zone of Le Mans right now. Meshman, actually, that's not Le Mans. That's going before Le Mans. This is Le Mans. I do apologize for that one, but Meshman looking to get a very good exit, misses the apex though. That's going to compromise his exit instead of benefiting, so he is just going to have to stay behind just for a couple more corners at least.
Yeah, and that's the key of driving angry. You start seeing those mistakes creep into the driving side. You can see he now takes that wider line, trying to open it up to use all of Sunset Ben on the exit, and he'll try and get that the best that he can. Will anyone come in? Yes, Ben Hackerson then will come in from this group. Will be interesting to see how he makes leeway moving on forward then into this race. Matthijs van Delden still on the lane, so his issues in. Martin Brandon's in, Dave White's in, Ben Hackerson will be seen in, so is Rick Fowler as well. We still have some battles. Chris Butterill then will go down to the inside of Jonathan Beresford. Battle to your rear of your field. So that's a very comfortable move then for the driver of Chris Butterill, who goes plus one then with that one as well, and making some great, great inroads then, as you can see right now. The gap at the front though is extending even further. It's now 5.5 seconds and counting here, Connery. And at the moment, Scott Brazier starting to run away with one.
Yeah, he is, and I think we're quite used to seeing a Bushfink 4 GT just at the front of the field, just pulling away, but I don't think it's usually this one.
No, I don't think it is, and you have to remember here, ladies and gentlemen, the championship leader and the other Bushfink 4 GT that we saw in Iru Nom is not here this evening. A race ban for comments that he said after the race that we saw at Road America last week, so that is the reason why he's not here. Same could be said for Jan Mletsever, who's been told, you know, you have to sit out of this one. I'm sorry, I'm afraid that's the rules of rules right now. And that is going to be the key then moving forward, is who keeps themselves out of trouble the most. Something that needs to be noted now is the battle here between the 48 and the 54 right now. Mike Mason and JPW Ring. Last time by, that gap closed in by about 0.7 seconds. And that gap looks pretty similar right now. Now Mike Mason under a little bit of threat then behind Jake Ringwood. And now it's the case of Ringwood trying to apply the pressure as they pass the Mobile One start-finish line.
Yep, and JPW Ringwood is one of your big movers during the race. He's up 7 positions already. Last time I went over, he was up 5 positions. So he's gained 2 positions in that time already. And he's looking to gain one more off of Mike Mason. And it looks very, very likely if his rate of catching him is going to continue. It was actually 0.2 seconds last time by as they came across the stripe. So JPW Ringer looking very, very good right now. But will he be able to get past Mike Mason before the pit stops? It's around about that time that you can come in right now. So does he decide to fight with Mike Mason, risk losing time, or does he decide to pit in now?
That's going to be the key here. And actually something that needs to be noted is all three of the drivers then who were stuck behind Raul Hooven, they've managed to just get themselves past then. And that's going to be key then in terms of Ben Hackerson's decision. He was being held up and now they are not held up anymore. So Meshan, Bed and Wormsley need to break away. Hooven has come down then onto the lane in your battle lower down in your field right now. But interesting battles going on. You've got Søren Kruse, who's lost the position to Adam Atherton, who's looking at Simon Underhill with a little bit of green eye envy right now as they head themselves up towards Bishop then. Fast left-hander at 140 miles an hour then. They look to try and go as they head now into this big right-hander. You can see taking a much wide line on entry there with Simon Underhill, looking to try and maximise the corner, and he gets himself a couple of tenths by the time he gets to Le Mans, time he gets there going forward. So this battle here for these three, this is going to be key going forward, as Daniel Page then in third position deals with the lap traffic, and more Herman right now, traffic now starting to become an issue.
Yeah, it can be, especially in this series where you have so many cars. And Adam Yatton had a little bit of a look there, but manages to get on the brakes a little bit. Very, very close to that wall right there, as we see Simon Underhill. He will actually hit pit road this time, just getting fuel to top off that car to the end.
Yeah, and that's going to be the key. He's the first then to have been out of that group battling for fourth position out on circuit. It'll be interesting to note then in the Page Warren battle if anything will happen with that, or if anybody can come back into play then as things go on. Also keep an eye out on this Mesham Baird Walmsley battle, because they're looking at Ben Hackerson thinking, you know, when is that going to happen? When is he going to come in? Will anyone come in? Yes, Paul Walmsley then from the back of the pack come in for that one then. He's pitting from 16th currently on the road, looking to make sure that he stays relatively in the same sort of position. So Paul Walmsley first to blink.
Yep, a couple of your drivers coming down pit road. Simon Underhill, Paul Walmsley are the only ones on pit road right now. Pretty much everyone else deciding to go at least one extra lap, as we look at the driver of Barry Bend. Look at him catch him, Gareth Mesham, coming through the first sector. Now coming through Big Bend, there was Gareth Mesham getting a little bit of oversteer on the exit of the corner. This will just give the momentum advantage to Barry Baird coming out of the corner. He'll sit in the slipstream of that Audi. He'll look towards the inside. That is an optimistic move for Barry Baird, but he makes it stick, or does he? They'll have to take a side-by-side coming out of hairpin. A little bit of contact on the exit of the corner. Mesham still ahead.
All fairness in love and war, and well, how did that end the way it did? They kept it together somehow and stay in position. So Barry Bend thought he had the move done with a very ambitious dive bomb attempt, but it didn't quite pay off for him, as Gareth Mesham holds position then just for the time being right now. Also, keep your eyes on this battle. JPW Ringwood is closing on Mike Mason. There is lap traffic then. They're trying to negotiate, trying to get past as well. That is going to be key then in terms of this one. The gap has come down a little bit though for your race leader, because he's down on pit road right now. Scott Brazier, your race leader, Conway, he's coming down onto pit road. He finds himself in the lane. He'll look to top up on fuel and tyres.
Yeah, and I don't think many people are going to join him this time by. You see the field just streaming by on the pit straight while Scott Brazier just sits on pit road waiting for that fuel to go in the car. No tyres, of course. Race is too short to be doing that. As we'll just have a little bit of a look at the pit stop times. It's usually around 20 seconds, and that is actually 21.5. And now we may have some issues with John Cook and Paul Walmsley. Oh, they've gotten into a little bit of a tangle right there. That was coming on the braking zone, coming down into Tower, I believe that is. And John Cook just running into the back of Paul Walmsley.
Yeah, John Cook then has to be careful. Walmsley's looking to try and make his way through the field, and he's stuck again behind Raoul Huben. So he's got to do all that work all over again. So that's going to be key when other people have got away, like the Ben Hackson, who has got away now, is looking at Underhill. Well, actually, Underhill's a mile away in the distance. Barry Baird has come down onto lane, so that will be interesting to look and see where he comes out in all of it. Simon Underhill, though, he's in a world of his own right now, trying to put in lap times together that he needs to do. Scott Brazier, though, has come out in a little bit of traffic there. He's got past Neil Bamber. Now he's got to get past John Roberts, who is arguably one of the gentlemen here of this Synology GT3 Championship right now. And for Scott Brazier being stuck behind traffic, it's the last thing he would have wanted, seeing as he amassed a 5-second lead.
Yeah, but it's going to take a lot of traffic in his way to have that 5-second lead eroded. Does he actually make it his way easily down the inside of that traffic right there? Neil Bamber having a little bit more of an issue, just losing a little bit of a couple of tenths right there. But couple of tenths, sometimes you have to lose it to get past lap traffic.
Yeah, sometimes you do, and that is going to be the key. Ben Warren then from fourth position, he'll drop himself down onto the lane. Eyes now on Underhill, because if Ben Warren then has himself a poor pit stop by means of, say, overshooting his box, speeding down on pit road, anything of the sort, that could be costly, and that could cost him potentially a fight for the podium position. Ben Warren, we haven't really seen him too much in this sort of position before. He hits his box and actually had to take a double take then, hitting himself onto the brakes. That will cost yourself a few little bits of a second. Also down in onto the lane just behind him is the driver of Adam Atherton, Mike Mason, comes down onto lane as well. So everyone then trying to get themselves a way onto lane. Where is Simon Underhill? He's running Sunset Bend right now, Connery.
Yes, he is. And Ben Roran still in his box. It's a 23.4 second stop or thereabouts. Simon Underhill just coming out of Sunset Bend right there. I believe Ben Roran will be out comfortably in front as Ben Roran just exits pit road. And, yep, Simon Underhill is quite way behind. He's only just entering turn one now.
Yeah, now Adam Atherton seems to have got the jump, but Adam Atherton does a great job, and he does well. He does very well, and he used the pit crew to his advantage as he gets the position. Runs wide, though, and now Underhill coming into play now here in the 007 machine. Looks around him, but you can't do it down at 3-4-5. Get the run, then, as they head through Big Ben, and now's the opportunity. He goes to the outside, but I think he's gone too early. He might try and look to the inside, but there will be no room to do that one. We'll have to do it around the outside, and Adam Atherton has placed the car very, very well. Great experience and great defending.
Yeah, exactly. As we see them coming through the lap, the little right out of the hairpin corner. Simon Underhill looking left, but he just files in right behind. He's looking right though. Will he get it done on the brace coming into tower? Nope. He thinks that's a little bit too risky and just files in behind. But this is losing him time to Ben Warren just ahead of this.
Yeah, race leader in as well. That's Jason Dilworth then in the 003 machine, who will drop himself down onto lane. The BMW Page will follow behind. So now it's a game of waiting. Where is everyone else? Will Soren Kroos, who's now currently in net third, come in? Yes, he will. So everyone now hitting the end of the limit. Reiners comes in, Ringwood comes in, and Ringwood right up to Reiners as he looks to try and play the game in the stops. But Daleman will also come in now. So Scott Brazier now will round Sunset Bend in that Ford GT, will look to try and push his Bushwick car away, and I think he will be out and away, and pretty much clear. Answer is going to be unchallenged, is he? I think he is, as he comes out, because Dilworth just gets out of the lane right now, and goodbye Scott Brazier. The lead now is his to lose.
It definitely is. There's a couple of guys still stopped down on pit road as Atherton and Underhill coming out of Sunset Bend right here. Here comes JPW Ringwood. Oh, very, very close to a couple of other cars just coming into pit road right there, as they will be nose to tail with Brandon Ramirez coming off of pit road. Underhill and Atherton just getting through turn one fine. They won't be battling with Soren Kroos as they come through turn one. But Underhill, he's still trying to look for that position. He had a couple of looks on the last lap, but he was not able to make any of them work as he looks to the left a little bit again, coming through the turn three right there. But actually, he's going to have the run coming through Big Bend, and he'll get this pass done, we think, around the outside, or maybe not. Adam Atherton just stretching the legs of that Audi. He will try and take it too wide, coming down into the hairpin turn. He will take the inside line. Simon Underhill again has to file in single file yet again, and Soren Kroos is catching up.
Yeah, and Soren Kroos and that McLaren will have all the advantage when it comes down to the straight. He's just got to make sure he is in range. A little look to the inside again then. Drives the driver of Simon Underhill, getting a little bit frustrated now. As you can see, again, Atherton doesn't use the full extent of the track. And because he's not using that full extent of the track, he is, in essence, pulling himself back into it and allowing Kroos to come back into it, the Norwegian driver, so that they can get themselves in a situation where he doesn't have to worry too much about the car behind if Kroos starts the battle with Simon Underhill in this big, big fight that is looking to continue onwards then as they head through the right and the left going on right now. We saw Gareth Mesham down on the lane just wondering to see where he's come out, and the answer is, well, he hasn't come out very favourably because he is stuck in that big tray. Actually, he gets a big slide and he'll take a half spin for his measures, and that is just summing up the day of Gareth Mesham. Round will go the driver of Martin Brandon. So, oh dear me, that is not what Gareth Mesham wants, and a horrible day he wants to put to bed in about 25 minutes time.
Yeah, it's been an absolutely horrible race for Gareth Mesham. Just incident after incident after incident. Single car slides, couple of car incidents everywhere. And yeah, I think he's looking forward to the end of this race in about 22 minutes right now. But looking towards actually Paul Walmsley right there. He's having a couple of issues. There's a battle between Chris Butterill and I believe that was Benjamin Haxson. Haxson through very, very easily. But the little will come down pit road right there. So he will bring that Wakefield printing a Mercedes down pit road. But I just want to go back to Scott Brazier. He's been up front. He's been, for the most part, setting sub 2 minute lap time. He hasn't set one very, very recently, but compared to the rest of the field, he's sometimes almost a full second ahead of everyone else.
Yeah, and that's the sort of area that you need to be targeting if you want these race wins. You've got to find that next level, that next gear. And that's what Scott Brazier is starting to show right now. Just look at this battle between Mike Mason and Ryan Atmore. Atmore has more Herman to try and deal with in the formula lap traffic. Look to try and get past that. We'll allow Mike Mason then to bring himself back into this battle here with just time running out, ticking away in this race right now under that Mobil 1 footbridge. You can see to the inside they're going to go, and he's going to try and thread the needle potentially, Mike Mason. Oh, it was brave, it was bold, but in the end he had the wherewithal to back out of it. So there, Mike Mason looking to try and take a chance right now.
Yeah, that is one word or phrase you could use to describe that. But Mike Mason all the way, almost on the back of Ryan Atmore, almost pushing his rear bumper through the corner.
Underhill.
Where is he right now? I cannot see. Take us through it, Jake.
Side by side, they come into Sunset Bend, and he'll take the position away from Atherton. Very good, but he gets a bit of a wiggle midway through the corner. That's going to push him wide, and here comes back Adam Atherton on the outside. Gets the run that he needs, moves to the outside then. We'll have to do it the long way around then as they head into turn number one. Inside line will only favour Simon Underhill in the 007 battle for fifth position then. Out on circuit, it will be all Underhills then, but he's pinched to the curb, but it won't matter then because there's nothing that Adam Atherton could do about it there. A mistake couldn't be capitalised on, and now Underhill needs to run away. It's 5 seconds to the driver of Ben Warren ahead.
Yeah, and that was because he was basically getting a little bit held up by the Audi of Adam A. Atherton. Atherton putting up an absolutely fantastic defensive fight to Simon Underhill right there, but he was basically holding Simon Underhill up, and Simon Underhill has to put in the laps of his life to try and catch up back to Ben Warren if Ben Warren does not have any incidents in the last third of the race right now.
Yeah, that is going to be the key. Something else that's starting to niggle with me a little bit is the driver of Benjamin Hackerson. He's starting to close in now on Neil Bamber there, who is up 11 positions right now to 11th position overall. And now he's got to deal with a very fearsome driver behind him. Bamber now looking to call in on his experience. Hackerson looking to come in with his youthful exuberance now. And the reigning champion here, you know, he's used two of his drop weeks already here, Connery. Potentially, he might be using a third with a finish like this after the incident he had at turn number one. This has not been ideal for many of the title contenders here today, and it's one where it's favoured only a couple of drivers looking for overall success.
Yeah, definitely. And I think Scott Brazier is the only person that we usually see at the front, actually at the front right now. The rest of the drivers, Jason Dilworth, not usually seen this far up. Daniel Page, Ben Warren, not usually seen this far up. Simon Underhill, I guess you could say you usually see him in and around that position. But yeah, again, Adam Atherton, not usually this far up. Soren Cruz, not usually this far up either. So, and I think I've said not usually this far up way too many times.
Maybe you have, maybe you haven't. That'll be up for other people then to decide that factor right now. Now Soren Cruz coming into this one in the battle for 5th, 6th, 7th. As things stands right now, looking to try and get back into this one. Hasn't been close at all in this one, Connor. You can see, heads himself into turn number 3. This is where the McLaren struggles, and it can't get all its power down into the tyres, into the road, and that's why you see the gap open up. But as soon as it can get that power down Big Ben, it's there where it starts to close itself in right now. And that's the problem that Soren Cruz has. You have one car change, Cruz hasn't used that yet, and that might be something he will look to visit.
Yeah, but as he goes a little bit too deep on the brakes, coming into the hairpin corner, just locks them up a little bit, but that gap has closed up due to that decent amount of straight coming out of Big Bend. But that Audi is going to be so dominant in the corners compared to the McLaren. And Soren Cruz very deep on the brakes again, yet he still manages to close that gap. So I see what Soren Cruz is doing right here. He has the straight line speed advantage, and he's maximizing it into the braking zone.
Yes, he is side by side, though. Ryan Atmore and Mike Mason in the 048. Mason to the inside, waited patiently, tried it 2 laps ago. We'll have it this time then. Down on the brakes into the hairpin and says thank you very much as they head to the Fangio chicane right now. Not too much of a chicane, but one nevertheless, as Ryan Atmore can't do anything then to get that move back. He might have a look down the inside, and you know what? He shows the nose, but it's not going to be close enough. John Cook waiting in the wings then, potentially, for any misdemeanors that happen. Ben Hackerson is through also on Neil Bamber then. So up into 11th position then is Ben Hackerson. I think his charge stops here because it's an 11-second gap here, Connery, to Bart Delman, who's lost the position to JPW Ringwood. And that's the problem for Ben Hackerson. All happened too early. Same for Barry Baird. And they can't make that ground up late in this race. It's one where it's really cost them late on.
Yeah, Barry Baird currently, if you don't take this race into account, Barry Baird second in the championship, and the driver of Benjamin Hackerson's in 12th position. And this isn't really going to be the day they wanted here at Sebring, or rather the night they wanted here at Sebring, as it is a night race. But now they just have to look towards the next couple of races just to try to recover. Remember, there are four drop weeks in this series. It's a 30-round series. Four of those you can take as drop weeks. Four of your lowest scores don't count.
Yeah, we're looking at the 15 here of Chris Butterill right now as he gets himself under threat. Ryan Walker, he's looking to try and find a way through on battle for 21st then here and at 22nd, having to deal with that driver of Paul Martin going down the inside, and that's very opportunistic, and the car runs wide as well there of Ryan Walker, so two for the price of one, thank you very much. Now Butterill will try and get himself in the 015, and you know what, he'll try and send it down the inside to Sunset Ben, and I think he might try and get the job done then. It'll be a great hold around the outside then for the driver of Ryan Walker. He's pinched there on the outside, and Butterill has to back out of that one then, can't get the move sorted. Great defense from Walker, but a mistake that he could ill afford to make. They're still happening as they head to turn one, Connery.
Yeah, Chris Butterill just looking for a little bit of stitching of the car, two cars ahead of him right there as they come down onto the brakes into turn one. Chris Butterill getting the back end out, that's just gonna lose him time all the way through the middle of that corner, and you can just see that gap visually opening up when they come to turn two.
Yeah, that is the key problem then that they've been facing. It's just going to be a case of just trying to keep the cars on the island, trying to keep them then to the finish line. Surprisingly though, we've only actually had one official retirement from this race so far, and that's the driver of Phil Rose there in the number 029 machine. Aside from that, cars are lapped down at a smaller grid to what we've normally been seeing. We've been seeing about...
No, it's definitely not over yet between Adam A. Atherton and Soren Kruse as they just come through the middle part of the lap right here. And this is where Soren Kruse is going to be at a pretty decent disadvantage. Adam A. Atherton in that Audi has got so much better cornering speed than the McLaren. But after Le Mans, Soren Kruse is definitely going to be benefiting from the huge straight line speed of that McLaren.
Yeah, and that McLaren is going to have to try and operate it and use it the best way that he can. But for the moment, it just seems that he can't use it the way he can. And that is going to be the problem that he's got coming out then. Coming into even here, the turn of Sunset Bend right now. As we stand here just to wait right now, we're going to take a commercial break. Well, stay with us. We'll be back after this.
It was more than impressive, I have to say. I mean, the track is identical to the real track. I was blown away how realistic it is. Every little bump, every little spray paint, everything is exactly like you're there at the track. It was a great experience.
This is a warm-up lap now. Tires to get warmed up. The engine. Breathe a little bit here when you go through that little bump there. And then it's flat pretty much all the way through here, just about. Hard braking. This is the slowest part of the track.
And then I've done, I did many races in Formula 3, Formula 2. And then I did the very last race they did there in Group C in 1983 in the 956 Porsche. That's when Beloff got the lap record at the 611. I think I was second on the grid with the 614 or something. Which was, those cars were awesome around there, of course, like any car is, that speed.
This is the corner of all corners here, the Schwede Kreuz. Flat all the way into it. And then trail brake all the way into the apex here. And then hard at it again to get good speed down the hill here. mega fast down this hill here. Just jump from one apex to the next. Gotta be super precise here.
I mean, it's almost exactly like the real thing. So, I mean, it is certainly realistic enough to get past a very, you know, a lot of the initial hurdles you have when you try to learn to drive a race car, you know. So, I mean, I think it's an excellent tool to learn how to race, for sure, or learn to drive a car on a racetrack.
Warriors troop on then. They look to continue here in this hour-long race here at a pitch black Sebring here. This is your Synology GT3 Championship on Racebot TV and streaming live on iRacing Live. Jake Sperry and Connery Maddock here in the commentary box. For those of you who are just tuning in, it's Scott Brazier then who has the lead of this one by 8.25 seconds. Exactly right now, he's been dominating from pretty much the drop of the flag. He took advantage of an incident with Gareth Mesham. He got himself away. He's broken away from Dilworth, and it's one where he hasn't been able to look back. Traffic, though, in the middle of your field right now. Now you've got Bram Reiners, then, who is looking to get into this fight right now. Cruz has made a mistake, dropped the position then to Bram Reiners, and now Reiners is looking to try and get all over the back of Adam Atherton. This battle for 6th and now 8th position as well is now starting to come into the forefront now, because Adam Atherton now feels the pressure a little bit more. Fingertips first, then the rest of the body.
Yeah, that's because Soren Cruz wasn't really getting towards the back of that Audi of Adam A. Atherton, but let's see what the Mercedes of Bram Reiners can do. There's some lap traffic ahead of him that just dives out the way there. Jason Withrow out onto the grass. A little bit too much getting out of the way right there from Jason Withrow, but we'd probably prefer too much rather than too little.
Yeah, you probably do prefer too much than too little. We don't want to see any incidents this late in the race. By my reckoning, I think we got ourselves about 5 laps to go. Can't be too sure. About 30 laps we're expecting then overall. Atherton holding on to this one here with the driver of Bram Reiners then looking to get himself back through. Oh, that's so brave! Coming down into Sunset Bend. Car comes out of nowhere of Dave White, and how he's managed to hold that one down the inside. That's a very brave move from Atherton, and you have to say, hats off and a round of applause.
Yeah, that was a fantastic move on a couple of lapped cars in Sunset Bend there from Adam A. Atherton. That was a very, very brave move indeed, like you said, Jake. He could have just stayed behind and got massively held up by those guys, but no, he just slung it right down the inside. Very, very risky move, I have to say, but he managed to pull it off. But still, this fight isn't over yet. Bram Reiners is still there and could have something to say by the end of this race.
Yeah, he certainly could. You also got to pay attention then to this battle going on. A mistake from Ben Hackerson in that last lap. Ben, the through has gone Barry Bear into 11th position. Both of these drivers started 5th and 6th. Both of them lap 1 in. Both of them then in trouble in terms of the championship point. And if you're asking where is your mainstay at the front of the field in Eru Nom, answer is not here. Race ban after comments after Road America means that he will skip out here this race of Sebring and wait for the race next week at Zolder, an incredibly tight, twisty, technical circuit, one where traffic will become a little bit more of an issue than it has been this evening. You can see Barry Bed holds the position for the moment. Hackerson will be looking to try and use everything that he's learned to try and get back into this one. And for the moment, not close enough. Paul Martin has spun himself around then down at Cunningham Corner there, and that's a self-spin, and that is one that Paul Martin really feels has really hampered him. He's down one lap down.
Yeah, meanwhile, there's a battle going on between the 12 and the 48. This is Paul Walmsley and Mike Mason. Actually, Paul Walmsley making his way through on the pass lap right there, coming down into turn one as they come out of the hairpin right now. Can Mike Mason reply to Paul Walmsley? That's the question we have to be asking. Mike Mason in that Grip TV Audi, just trying to get towards the back a little bit, almost a little bit too much right there. Coming down into the braking zone for Tower Corner, almost running right into the back of the rear bumper of Paul Walmsley as he deals with that. Actually, that is bad for position. That's Roel Huben. What has happened to Roel Huben? He's just lost a lot of time right there. And now he's been passed by Paul Walmsley. He risks being passed by Matt Mason as well.
Yeah, now Mason looks to the inside there as they come to Bishop. Not enough, but the room had to be given there by Raoul Huben. He couldn't trust the spotter that he's got on him. Down into the right hand, and they come along looking to set up towards Le Mans. Raoul Huben has been a thorn in many people's sides this evening, being the fact that he has been almost impossible to overtake. A little bit wide though ahead though, ran the driver there of Paul Wormsley, and that's going to put him under a lot of pressure then as they come down his back straight. But he's fortunate in the fact that there's Alan McCain just ahead there, who is managing to be that little helper slipstream as they head themselves down into Sunset Bend. All is fine, out of the way gets Alan McCain. Through will go these three drivers. Thank you very much. And you can see now, here comes the driver of Mike Mason, and you can see he's just forced away to the inside. Raoul Huben had to leave the room. Nothing can happen about that. To the inside, let's go. And thank you very much. No, tries to hold it around the outside and will hold it around the outside. Great defense.
Yeah, that was Raoul Huben just getting a little bit of oversteer coming through the middle of Sunset Bend. Gave Mike Mason the advantage and the run out of the corner. But Raoul Huben managed to successfully defend around the outside right there, as actually Mike Mason takes a very, very wide line just right here in the corner before Big Ben. This will actually give him a great exit as he just closes and closes and closes up, looks towards the left-hand side of the track and looks towards the right-hand side of the track. He will try to take the inside for a hairpin right here as they have a little bit of a door bang coming down into the corner. But that will be Mike Mason through, and also Alan McCain, who's actually just a lap down. But that's still going to be frustrating for Raoul Huben.
Yeah, it certainly will be, especially in the late stages then of this event. It's one where those points can rack up and mean something come the end. They're currently a little bit wide in front of Ryan Atwell there. That's Rick Fowler, who has been lapped traffic all day long. Neil Bamber then looking to try and get back into this one. At one stage, was running up towards 11th position. Now down in 15th and has paid the price and has peaked a little bit too early in my opinion, and now is starting to struggle just that little bit. You can see ran a little bit wide there through the corner, couldn't do anything about it. Now JPW Ringwood's under pressure now as Barry Baird is making a late surge through the field right now here, Connery, all over the back with about three laps to go.
Yeah, as we see Neil Bamber actually just get around Ryan Atmore, will he? They're coming down into the braking zone for Sunset Bend. Oh, almost contact there between your two drivers. Ryan Atmore having to push wide, but will he reply on the exit of the corner? That actually pushing wide a little bit there will actually help you on the exit of the corner, since it is particularly a double apex corner. Here comes Ryan Atmore in the slipstream on the pit straight. Look towards the outside of turn one, but you'll have to maybe back out of that one. Actually, he's just trying a very slightly adventurous line right through there, but he's still right on the back of Bamber.
Yeah, he certainly is. I'm just seeing here headlights flashing, and that's Bram Reiners, who's looking to try and get around that lap traffic there, that driver of Jonathan Beresford right now. This is the battle for sixth position. We've been talking about this ever since the pit stop window here. It was originally Underhill, Atherton and Cruz, but then Bram Reiners came into it with a little bit of fortunate, but he just can't seem to get onto the back of Adam Afton. The gap was 3/10 when they last crossed the line. Now that gap seems a little bit more then, as he got a little bit unfortunate with the lap traffic that was playing its role. Two laps to go then here, Connery, as they next cross the line. Scott Brazier out and away, the gap extending even further, 13 seconds even, let's say the gap is right now. It's a brilliant race from Scott Brazier, and it will be, without any mistakes or incident, a second win of the season for him.
Yeah, he has been absolutely dominant in this race. No one has really come even close. Just look at the lap time. Scott Brazier last time out did a 2 dead, pretty much 2 minute dead. Jason Dilworth, the car in second place, did a 2:09. That is pretty much a second right there.
It is, and now to the outside tries Barry Baird in the 006 on JPW Ringwood. Ringwood, though, has to run wide because of the parabola he tried to take. And now you can see a big wiggle coming out of the exit, has to back out of it. Here comes Barry Baird looking for the top 10 then to the outside. He tries to go, and now he'll try and switch it to the inside. And you know what? Ringwood hasn't skipped it coming, and down to the inside he'll go, and down to the inside. For the moment, he'll take the remain side by side. They touch, and round they both go. Into the wall goes Ringwood, into the wall goes Barry Baird, and the championship that he thought he'd inherit the lead of goes now completely up in smoke for Barry Baird. And Ringwood then and himself have come together, and now with just not much time remaining, oh dear me, Connery, a big late development.
a very, very big one. And that also means that Benjamin Hackerson, he actually gains a couple of positions as a result of that incident. Also, a couple of drivers down in the field, they will also gain a couple of positions as well in this late stages in the race. So that may have just saved Benjamin Hackerson's race right there.
It might do, and it might be crucial come the end. Remember the four drop weeks that come into effect. That might be something to look out for then as things continue right now. Bram Reiner's then looking still at the back of Adam Atherton. Not happening for the moment. We'll see if it can happen. Coming towards sunset. Ben, he looks close. He looks quite close. Maybe he can get the run on it. Gap about 2.5, 3/10 of a second. Looking to close a little bit more and more. This will be the white flag lap. This will be the final lap then of your event right now as we hit 5:10 at UK time. Into the right-hander they come along. Atherton a little bit of a double take. And now here tries the drive then of the driver of Bram Reiner's. Not going to happen then, I don't think, into turn number one. He'll have to wait for this one to happen at a later stage because it's not going to happen. Down into the big left-hander. This was the incident that we saw just a couple of minutes ago. And actually, running out a little bit wider line there was the driver of Adam Atherton. But it won't matter then for the driver of Bram Reiner's. He can't get close enough as things stand right now. You can still see, though, there will be drivers who will be looking at this, thinking that this was not their day. Drivers like Ben Hackerson, drivers like Paul Wormsley, drivers like Gareth Mesham, who have struggled. JPW Ringwood off in the grass right now. This is the white flag. This is the last lap of the race. The timer has expired. And, well, you can see right now, Scott Brazier must be incredibly happy with himself and smiling on his face. You can see into the right he comes along, looking then potentially for this big left that opens up to Le Mans in a Ford GT. A Ford GT with Bushwick colours that we have seen win time and time again in these opening five races of the season. But this time, it will not be an Estonian who takes to the podium. Oh no, it will be Scott Brazier this time. No Eru Nom. No Eru Nom this week. But it hasn't mattered as he rounds Sunset Bend for the final time in this event, and Scott Brazier will become a two-time winner and will look to take the fight and potentially look to take a championship decisively as they head to Zolder. Great work and a dominant victory from the driver of Scott Brazier when all was said and done. Second place will go to Jason Dilworth. A great drive from Dilworth there. And Daniel Page will come home then in the 028 machine in third position overall. Done a good job there. Isn't going to be a fight between Reiners there and also Adam Atherton. So you have to say a beautiful, beautiful race driven with perfection from the front there, Connery.
Yep, as we see a couple of your runners down the field coming across the line, as Adam Atherton just coming across the line, Bram Reiners also just having to settle for 7th place, and Soren Kruse gives a little bit of a flash of the lights as he comes across the line as the fireworks light up the sky.
Yeah, the fireworks then in full effect then for Bushwick. Not going to count for the constructors, they haven't entered into that respect, but there has been some pretty great battling. Still got likes then of Raul Huben looking to get around the driver then of Dave White. Lap traffic then going forward. You can see drivers there at the end looking to try and get a little bit of an aggression on here, like Alan McCain, who I think's just taken the position away from Dave White. No, Dave White is 2 laps down then as things stand. Look about Paul Wormsley then here in the 012 machine, that 17th position right now. A day where he needed to find points, a day which has ended in dismay for the driver of Paul Wormsley there, Connery.
Yeah, definitely, and you can see that about a couple of drivers in your field. Gareth Mesham, definitely one of those drivers. He's had an absolutely instant-ridden race. JPW Ringwood also dropping down the field as well when he needed to get a good result. But Vision, who has gotten the good result, perhaps the best of all the results, it is Scott Brazier.
Yeah, and let's get these results then up on your screen. This is how everything has finished come the end of this race. Scott Brazier then takes a dominant victory here under the floodlights at Sebring by 15.8 seconds when all was said and done. Jason Dilworth second with Daniel Page in third. Ben Warren will come home then in fourth position with Simon Underhill there in fifth, with Adam Atherton sixth, with Bram Reiner seventh. Soren Kruse has a very solid drive, finishing 8th overall, continuing his run of finishes here in BOSRA right now in the Synology GT3 Championship. Bart Dahlman then will come home in 9th, and Ben Hackerson recovering to finish 10th. Barry Bed's late drama means he drops to 11th position. John Cook there in 12th overall, with Neil Bamba getting himself up a few more positions come the end in 13th. Ryan Atmore will finish 14th plus 6 for the day, with Mike Mason there in 15th. Raoul Hooban up 5 in 16th. He was there being a big key issue for many drivers looking to make their way through the field. Paul Walmsley then in 17th position, started 7th. Philip Gregory there is the last of the cars on the lead lap. Gareth Mesham then finishes one lap down. So does the likes of Chris Butterill, the likes of Jonathan Beresford, John Roberts. JPW Ringwood's injury woes coming towards the end of the race means that his day is only 25th, and he needed that as one of the key members in terms of scoring in the top 10 of the championship. And then you got the likes of Matthijs van Delden then struggling, Andrew Tobut struggling, Moore Herman struggling, and so does Phil Rose, who is technically the only driver technically who has failed to finish the race. We're going to step aside, ladies and gentlemen, when we come back. Post-race coverage to you of your Synology GT3 Championship. Don't go away. Beautiful race under the floodlights, and it has ended the way of Scott Brazier when all was said and done. He takes the dominant win then by an astounding 15 seconds come the end of this race, and he gets it pretty much in front of the man that we're going to speak to right now. Jason Dilworth here in post-race coverage, brought to you by RaceSpot TV on iRacing Live. Jason, second place for you today, a welcoming second place for you, a nice trip to the podium and one that we haven't seen so far, and it's very nice to see for the fans.
Yeah, thanks. It was a bit of a boring race after the initial shenanigans, and but yeah, really welcome to have it after the awful race I had last week.
Well, of course, going from madness to what is a very good mystery that we could say here. The opening few laps then, always going to be difficult. They change it to a rolling start to kind of cut out the incidents that happened early on. But for you, you were starting to lose the back then of the leading duo that were looking to get away into the forms of Mesham and in the form of Brazier as well. Battling between them brought you back into it, and then we saw what happened with Mesham, and in the end it was a case of breakaway and stay away, and for you, breakaway and stay away is what you did.
Yeah, they got away pretty quick, and then made a bit of battling amongst themselves, so I was able to catch back up, and then obviously Mesham had his issue. That was a pretty hectic point, but my only goal then was to stick with Scott, and as soon as I lost his draft, he just had way too much pace today. Really good performance by him.
Really good performance, but next week we head over to Zolder. Now, Zolder, a circuit where top speed isn't really the key to a circuit like that. It's all about acceleration. It's all about getting up that power, and for a car like yours in the BMW right now, you're sitting right now, you're looking at maybe more of an advantage, more of a chance for you to score some more points. And of course, with the championship leader not being here today and you getting some very crucial points on him in that respect, for you, is it going to be a case of Zolder's going to suit your style maybe more than some others?
Yeah, a lot of people, they moved away from the BMW. I've kind of stuck with it, knowing that there were some more decent tracks for the BMW coming up. So I'm really hoping that I can turn that into good points when those tracks are here. You know, places like that and Watkins Glen are going to be good opportunities for the BMW drivers.
Certainly will be. And before I let you go, is there anyone you'd like to thank for your second place here this evening?
Just everyone who runs BOSRA, although I'm on the admin team myself, there's a lot that goes on behind the scenes, and I'd like to thank all of them and all of the sponsors that make it all possible to have you guys doing the great job that you do.
Well, thank you very much there. Jason Dilworth coming home in second position overall. Connery, you're speaking to Mr. 007 himself in the form of Simon Underhill.
Yes, indeed. I have Simon Underhill right here, part of the Synology team, coming home in fifth place when all is said and done. You actually qualified 15th place, so fantastic charge through the field right there. What was it like?
Oh, it was a hard race. It was one that you had to work hard for. But to come 10 places up to 5th, I'm elated with that again. After last week's race at Road America and finishing 41st, I had to do really good this week, knowing that I'm not going to be able to race next week. So I'm really pleased with this result. Some really good battles with Adam Atherton and Ben Warren as well. At the point in time, we were trying to catch Ben, but I just couldn't quite get it at the end of the race.
No, you couldn't quite get it. Mostly because you were battling with Adam A. Atherton, just losing 10th by 10th each lap. So that was pretty much what happened there. You're currently around about, you're actually in 8th in the championship before this race started. No doubt you'll be much further up the field after a decent result of a 5th place right here. Closing the gap between to the likes of the Bears, Ringwood, Bamber, Parks. And looking ahead towards Zolder, actually, we head to Belgium. Not Spa, but Zolder. Is it a track you like?
Not really keen on Zolder, but like I say, it's a race that I won't be at because unfortunately I've got other things that I need to do, like go on holiday, so I'll be missing that one. But yeah, I had to get a good position and finish this race just to try and make up that deficit of I'm going to lose next week. But good result for Team Synology as well, with Ben Ackerson finishing in 10th and also Jonathan Beresford finishing as well. So yeah, really happy for this race.
Yeah, Hackerson had to have a little bit of a recovery drive after a first lap incident right there. But coming back to this race, actually, how was the night element for you?
Very different than Daytona. So when we raced at Daytona at night, it was well lit in the midfield section of Sebring. There's no light at all, so you're really generally chasing other cars' headlights. It's really poor, but once you get used to it and you're getting a bit of a groove, or the groove as the racers call it, it's not so bad. And like I say, you have to work hard for it. You have to just make sure you hit those apexes every lap, every time.
Yep. How about the change to a rolling start instead of a standing start for the sprint races of this series? For the endurance races, we've always planned it to be a rolling start, but after a couple of first lap incidents we saw earlier on in the season, the Amids decided to change it to a rolling start. How do you think that affected things?
Yeah, I'll be part of the admin team anyway, myself. It was a change that we thought would help. It would sort of settle down the front part of the race. You know, we've had a lot of incidents at the very beginning of the race and a lot of people complaining about other people, so we had to make a change. And I think looking at the, from my point of view, looking at the result of today's start, I think it went pretty well. I managed to gain a lot of places at the start, which again for me was good. So I think it's definitely the way forward, and also it falls in line with the blank pan sprint series that iRacing run anyway, so people should be used to the rolling start rather than standing start.
Yeah, standing starts are relatively unusual for GT3 cars, but that change is going to be one that you're bringing forward through the rest of the season, as that was Simon Underhill finishing 5th place in the race here at Sebring. Back to you, Jake.
Yes, and unfortunately that will be all that we have time for then this evening. A big thank you then to everyone who's been racing, to everyone of you who has been watching at home, and well, to a brilliant race that we have seen at Sebring. Dominance again with a Ford GT, dominance again for a driver in Bushvink colours, but today it would not be Irunom, it would not be that driver who was leading the championship. Instead, it would be Scott Brazier, who will now match his so-called teammate with a second win of the season. Don't forget, though, that we have ourselves a full host of programs here on RaceBot TV later on in the week, likes of the Prototype and GT Challenge that will be coming to you from the Nürburgring. Raven Graphics Contenders for your Oval fans. Formula Renault 2.0 Championship, the Skip Barber 2K World Cup, and well, you got both Gathering of Tweakers and Neo Endurance Series races going on during the weekend. And don't forget, Indy Elite Series will be happening in the evening, the late, late hours of Sunday night. And don't forget Monday Night Skippies as well. It is one of those things then around a circuit like Sebring, looking forward then to Zolder, looking forward then to one of those races Will there be a return to form for many drivers who have struggled today? Will there be the return of Iru Nom that might see the championship sway back in his favour? The only place you can watch here is RaceBot TV and iRacing Live. Good night.